Hi everybody, this is Dr. Ed Park. Today we're doing a webinar on mesenchymal stem cells. What we see here is an electron micrograph of these little critters, and we're going to explore a little bit what they are. One of my favorite quotes from the Hendrix cover of the Dylan song is, "Let us not talk falsely now, the hour is getting late." And I participate in some of these online forums, like on Facebook, and there's a lot of people who are perhaps expert or perhaps like to talk a lot, but the fact is that nobody's an expert on stem cells. People don't know that much about them. In the final edit, you'll see that this picture is actually a GIF, and these critters are moving around like little amoebas, and they have agency, so it helps to think of them as little musicians, if you will, to extend that musical analogy. Goals of today's talk will be to talk about what a MSC is, what's its role, what's inside their exosomes, and how do they perform their actions. All speculative, nobody knows. I certainly am not an expert. I am just translating what I see. The penultimate slide is going to be in the front now, and we're showing what is, for those that don't know, an exosome. I had to amend this, probably it's one, I used to say 3/400, probably 1/1000 when you compare it to the size of the actual cell that's producing it in general. It's tiny. They're released in these bundles, these batches of tiny spheres, and inside are mainly proteins, mRNA, and a subclass of the mRNA is called microRNA, which are blockers of mRNA transcription, which we'll get into quite a bit today. They are not cells. They don't have the machinery of the nucleus, and they don't make their own energy, and they don't have their own system of cycling endosomes. So they are only the message. Let's think of it as a song. And they don't have self-antigens. In other words, in general, some of the exosomes from immune cells may have certain antigens, but those histocompatibility antigens, the ones that are involved with like whether you're yourself or foreign, or the graft or host, immune rejection, those are not present, which is good because that translates to safety and universality. Above, we see a chart of just some of the trials that have used exosomes as drug carriers. It's kind of a no-brainer. They've been working on it for at least 10 years. What we see is that a phospholipid bilayer, because most of our cells are just phospholipid bilayers with specialization on the surface and especially on the inside, you can take a little phospholipid bilayer, it's like a butter ball, and it'll match up and mate and communicate with the other butter balls. This is the way that it's done. This year we've had a real surge to get the Moderna and the Pfizer COVID vaccines, and we can think of these as a one-note samba. So they also have the same 100 nanometer spherical butterball, and inside is allegedly the mRNA for the spike protein of the coronavirus. So much ado about very little. They have one mRNA, and the hope is that you will safely express the spike protein somewhere, somehow, and somewhere, somehow, you will devise an immune response that will somehow protect you from future infection, although the asterisks are many in terms of adverse reactions, overreactions, partial immunity, and the need to still do all the PPE. But it is a one-note samba, and of course, if we knew what the heck we were doing, we could use exosomes to treat other conditions, most notably cancer. And I always say that cancer could be curable, but it's not, you can't make money off of it. So every cancer has one or two genes that are deleted usually, and it allows it to misbehave. So you could just introduce that mRNA for your particular cancer and do it in a way that is not destructive, that is purely, for a moment you wake up those cells and they figure out how to execute their death program or stop misbehaving, and then we have bespoke cancer cures. But before we go on, we need to talk about what is a stem cell. Even this is very, very vague. Of course, on the top left, we see a fertilized egg. That's when your mom's sperm or your mom's egg and your dad's sperm got together. And your one fertilized egg was a stem cell, and you became 7 trillion cells walking around and thinking and doing webinars. what makes for stemness is very vague, it's very subjective, but there's two things. One is shown to the left, telomerase activation, meaning there's this little printing press. In humans, it's 6, in plants, it's 7, in some fungi, it's 20-something. It doesn't really matter what the message is, but it prints out lengthening message on the end of the chromosome so that they don't whittle away and erode with each cell division, and that gives them immortality. In the middle, we see the diagram of what stemness is. Stemness is a mama makes a daughter and a perfect mama. So it's asymmetric division. We don't really understand how that works, but it just means that a mama can live forever and she'll make off a little specialized daughter and copy a immortal mama. But of course, at the bottom, we see that there can be an intermediate pluripotency, meaning the mom can make a mistake, forget, she can glitch, her software can be altered epigenetically. And so that's kind of shown above. This is from a paper about brain cancer. And what we see here is that the traditional model we were taught is that differentiated cells become cancer. They learn how to be stem-like. But what we see is the truth is B. Nobody knows. It could be Roman numeral 1, 2, or 3. You could get, as I've said in my first book, Telomere Time Bombs, cancer could be a disease of stem cells. They already have the telomerase. They're already from the planet Krypton. They can do crazy things and fly. So they're the ones that become cancerous. And it's about 50-50, the research oncologists say, well, cancer is a stem cell disease. It's not. It probably could be both. So we see the intermediate progenitors, the neural, the astrocyte, the oligodendrocyte. These can de-differentiate, or even the original thing that we were taught, that differentiated brain cells can become stem-like. So the bottom line, take-home lesson is nobody knows. Nobody knows how these things behave. So say you want to hear some music. You want to hear a Led Zeppelin song. Well, do you have an iPod and just play it? Great, you hear the music. That's very nice. But you could also invite the musicians in. And this is a picture recently of Robert Plant looking at his own self, Robert Plant, on the Sunset Hotel. And rock bands were famous in the 70s for kind of misbehaving and trashing hotel rooms. The drummer John Bonham was famous for riding his motorcycle in the middle of Chateau Marmont. Anyway, point being, a lot of people talk about stem cell therapy. There have been hundreds of trials of mesenchymal stem cells for this, that, and the other with mixed results. And part of the reason is, again, self-antigens. That's the benefit of exosomes. They don't have self-antigens. So what we see in the cartoon is that we have the major histocompatibility 1 and 2. And this is the secret handshake that you have in your cells. And everything that comes in rightfully is recognized as foreign and is destroyed. So what we have is a situation of host versus graft and graft versus host. And therein lies the rub. People say, well, I traveled, spent, $15,000 to go to some country and get stem cells. From yourself, that's fine, but they're old and damaged. It's like the old Robert Plant trying to rock out to his tunes. But you can get younger ones, but are they going to trash your hotel room, so to speak? The younger mesenchymal stem cells are probably going to get destroyed by immune system within days. So the benefit would be mitigated. So what's in an exosome? Somebody contacted me on Facebook and said, well, does anybody know about these neural stem cells exosomes? I said to her, there's a lot to unpack there. Nobody really knows. All we know is if you go through the literature, and there is quite a bit of literature from the last 12 years, people analyzing what's in the exosomes. People didn't even know to look for the exosomes before 12 years ago. Now they realize, oh, if you have clinical hepatitis, liver cirrhosis, if you have breast cancer, if you have urinary failure from lupus, you get all these different exosome profiles. We don't even know what it means. It's as if you were to take all the notes from a symphony and plop them down on a page and say, now I understand. You don't understand anything, okay? So the song does not remain the same. In other words, all cells can produce many different kinds of exosomes. How they do that, why they do that, we don't know. The jukebox above is a little more accessible to us. We have a finite number of songs it can play, but we have to realize that the cells are musicians and the songs they play are all different. And I think the take-home lesson here is people say, well, exosomes good, are they bad? Well, they're neither, they're just songs. So if you take the exosomes from a woman with breast cancer that's metastatic, put them in a normal woman, you'll see some malignant transformation. So those are bad exosomes. If you take a person who's overcoming liver cirrhosis, put them into someone with liver cirrhosis, they can tend towards going against that progression. So there is no universal way to describe what's in exosomes. And as we'll see shortly, the complexity is quite nearing infinite. The fellow that named them is still alive. He's Arnold Kaplan, PhD, and he was doing orthopedic research. And in 88, he named them. And this is a great video you should watch. I think I link it later, tinyurl.com, Arnold Kaplan, MSC. And so his whole thing is now, if you watch this 50-minute video, he talks about what they are, what they do. It's very compelling. It's entertaining. But he's the one who named them, and he says, I was wrong, flat out. He said, they're not mesenchymal stromal. They live in the vessels, okay, the sinusoidal vessels of the bone marrow. And although they've been very proud that in vitro they can cause them to differentiate, they can take one of these little critters that look just, they're fibroblasts, they're little amoeboid fibroblasts, and they can read them different messages, and they'll become bone or muscle and cartilage. And they said, oh, how clever we are. We can whisper to these cells, and they'll become other things. But in vivo, he now rejects. So he's gone from saying, okay, MSCs become all these things. Now he says they don't in vivo. He may be right and wrong. He's covered all bases. The only thing that they can say about stem cells in this way is that they have plastic adherence, meaning they stick to the dish, and they can be differentiated, as I just mentioned. So his big push now in his end of his career, we presume, is he wants to rename them medicinal signaling cells. In other words, he believes that the lion's share of what they do is not from differentiation, but rather from sending out bespoke exosome packages. And that's why he wrote this article a few years ago in 2017 saying it's time to change the name. Interesting. Remember the old Clairol ad, does she or doesn't she? I presume they meant dye her hair. So here's Arnold's lecture, and he's talking about how, oh, mea culpa, in 88, I thought they could, just because I could make them differentiate into everything, that was their primary role. I don't think so. I think they're like barefoot doctors now. And this chart, which is commonly seen, mesenchymal stem cell on the left, becoming all these things, it's true in vitro, but now people are saying, is it really true in vivo, in the body? I even have a copy of a chart like this in my first book. So this dogma is in flux. And it reminds us of this pie chart, this Pac-Man. He's saying, well, what you know is the green, and what you know you don't know for sure is the violet. But what you don't know is the Pac-Man. So this is true for almost everything in life. And we're reminded of this corny movie, Face Off, where John Travolta and Nicolas Cage trade faces. Well, it could be that Arnold was right all along, and that just because you can't show evidence of it in vivo, they might be changing their faces. In other words, the differentiation markers, you don't really have a real-time way to know whether those pericytes, which are MSCs, actually became and differentiated into other useful tissue types in vivo. So I think the jury is out, at least my intuition says so. But here he is again, tinyurl.com, Kaplan MSC, really entertaining, accessible lecture. I recommend you watch it. And he's trying to backpedal on this, saying, no, I was wrong. They do, we know, express slightly different behaviors depending on which organ they come from. So they're in the small vessels of all the different organs, and they play different music, if you will, depending on where they're from and what their conditions are. So after injury, MSCs are vital. If you get a cut or inflammation or destruction, the blood vessels need to proliferate. It needs to orchestrate the repair somehow with these exosome signalings. And because you get this damage, normally immune cells will come in and say, okay, who's to blame? Well, who do we kill? So it also dampens the autoimmune response, so you don't develop an autoimmune response. And they help to orchestrate the regeneration. These groovy-looking guys, Walter Becker, Donald Fagen, of course, the core of Steely Dan. I was watching a Making of Asia on the plane, I think, and I was one of my favorite albums, Asia, A-J-A, and their process was really interesting. They invited studio musicians in, and they would do multiple takes, and even though it was like perfect by anyone's standards, they got studio musicians, and the point is that these MSCs are like studio musicians. If you ask a studio musician to come in and play a square dance gig or a bar mitzvah or, you know, a grunge rock or even a straight ahead jazz session or classical music, they could do it because they have many talents. And so let's not forget that stem cells have many talents. And so we should not pigeonhole them. Speaking of pigeons, good segue. This movie, Young Frankenstein, the line was, "It's alive," right? So he reanimates Frankenstein and or Frankenstein. And the point is that exosomes are not alive, but the cells that produce them are. And so jumping down to the bottom, there's terroir, which is the idea in oenology, or Vintner says, well, if it was a bad year for climate or the terrain and the soil is rough, you'll get a stronger wine. And so the point being, once you've thawed out the stem cells, you know, I was talking to the owner and chief scientist of Chimera, and I asked him, you know, is the product of your stem cells the same from batch to batch? And he said, yes. But I think I heard, or at least I believe, there's a huge asterisk there as well. So let's look at this Star Wars analogy. From Brave New World, they have actually a technology that's here already for sheep and maybe for humans soon, is cloning in vitro. And so you gestate them in these little tubes or whatever, and you get a clone army all from one guy, Boba Fett, with a Maori accent. The point is that I don't know for sure, but I'm able to infer that the process is they had mesenchymal stem cells from a placenta harvested years ago, so they don't have to retest for infection, same placenta donated at C-section. And what they do is every few months they thaw out of a batch and they expand it, you know, double, and then you get millions of cells and they're laying your exosome eggs. So the question is, what is the first song that the bird sings when it comes out? So you wake up this clone army guy, the first bird chirp, it depends on the programming, right? But if you can look this up in journals and books, depending on the oxygen conditions, the conditions of light, of sound even, of course, these cells have agency. And so it would be a bit disingenuous to believe, not to say, but to believe that the product, the exosomes, are going to be the same from batch to batch. They are probably not. The final caveat is HeLa, Henrietta Lacks cervical cancer cell above. This is terribly abnormal. As a result of telomere shortening, the chromosomes become abnormal number shape. And so, but nevertheless, out of the box, HeLa cells are used for scientific research all the time. Why? Money. Because they're patented, because they're owned. And so this is a real big problem in science and in pharmacology, and it touches a little bit on the subject of the FDA, what it's for, and what it's about. Okay, the other great video I want to refer you to is tinyurl.com, Nguyen MSC. That's a link I made. This scientist a few years ago put together a study of what's in her MSC exosomes. And as you might expect, a lot of different things. The study is called The MicroRNA Regulatory Landscape of MSC-Derived Exosomes. And with Ferguson, Dr. Nguyen went and analyzed. And you could do this. It's a trivial thing, but what does it mean? So if you look at this Venn diagram over here, we see the MSC in blue, the embryonic kidney in red, and the prostate cancer in green. And you see there's some overlap in the middle. Each of them have their own unique miRNAs or blocking mRNAs, and that's just a hint at the complexity we're talking about. In the middle top, we see machine learning, which is this way of learning that we don't have. Of course, we like names. Names get in the way. The actual way that we think of causation, the arrow of time, binary categories, is very limiting in our ability to understand. So somehow, I presume that some artificial machine learning came up with this diagram to the middle, and it shows, well, these are the pathways that are being influenced by these different molecules that are present in the exosomes, and it looks like some kind of strange heat map. Even stranger is below the predicted biological processes, so another level of abstraction shows you just how nutty and confusing it can be, and you know, they just are guessing, they're taking a stab using their machine that it's involved with circulation, blood vessels, cardiovascular. I mean, this is all many layers of inference and deductive, inductive reasoning, garbage in, garbage out. Let's get a little bit back to earth now. So Arnold talks and other people reiterate that MSCs are antibacterial. Thank God, knock wood, I haven't really had, I haven't had any infectious comorbidities from treatments, approaching 500 treatments now. So they do have an innate antibacterial thing, which is important because we're in spaces like the spinal canal occasionally. So LL37 is one of them. Other defensins are present. So they are a bacteriostatic, if not bactericidal, which is great and confers a lot of safety. Another thing we know about MSCs generally is that they're immunomodulatory. We kid ourselves that these are the only signals they're giving, but these are just representative. So for example, IL-6, prostaglandins, nitric oxide, they're influencing the behavior, orchestrating the immune system. The result of which is decreased immune inflammation by shifting from a T1 to T2 sort of phenotype in the T cells, and the macrophages become less inflammatory and they become M2 from M1. And I think it's kind of important to realize that MSCs play an important role in fetal tolerance. In other words, the fetus is a genetically totally distinct individual inside the mom, so the immune system would generally destroy it if not for the MSCs that are downregulating that host versus graft. All right, we'll kind of just blow through these slides. These are adapted from one of the scientists that used to work at Chimera. So when they did their own in-house assays, here are some of the heavy hitters or stars that they speculated might be involved. GDF11 is a recent prominent peptide that has been touted as an anti-aging agent. Other things such as granulocyte colony stimulating factor, a TGF-beta, VEGF is huge, vascular endothelial growth factor. We know that MSCs do bring in more blood supply, and that's why they're there in every organ on those blood vessels. Other things, the different interleukins are leukocyte signaling molecules. There's a chemotractin protein, MCP1. Platelet-derived growth factor, beta. Common theme we see is there are a lot of growth factors. Tissue inhibitor of matrix metalloproteinases is an important thing that blocks collagen degradation, and it's very important in regrowing cartilage. A hepatocyte growth factor, again, the names are limiting because based on who discovered them and what importance or value they assign, the name is a legacy and it kind of impedes our understanding. Hepatocyte growth factor is probably not just working on hepatocytes, but there we go. Glial-derived neurotrophic factor, brain-derived neurotrophic factor. You'll sometimes see Facebook ads talking about BDNF, helping to freshen the mind. Fibroblast growth factor, etc. I don't expect you to understand this slide, but this is some of the mRNAs or messenger RNAs. You can see the histogram showing the relative expression of these. You see a lot of insulin-like growth factor proteins, other GFs, growth factors, VEGF. Continue on, big spike there in the tissue, matrix metalloproteinases. Another slide from in-house comparing their exosomes with their amnio products, very different product profile. What we see here is that, again, VEGF, endothelial growth factors, prominent hepatocyte growth factor. Another page showing these very high counts in the amniotic product of IGF binding proteins. And mind you, these are just the proteins. These aren't even the mRNAs, which they can fully assay, let alone the microRNAs, which are kind of the secret de-differentiation blockers, if you will. So I think the magic lies there, and it's kind of beyond human comprehension. Going on here, another type of readout looking at the relative concentrations in their exosome products. This is very, very complex. It is a finite number of notes they're playing, and we don't really know what effect they're having in terms of the song. And it reminds me of this wonderful raga mala. You can Google that and listen to Ravi Shankar, the famous Indian musician. So to ask what's in an MSC exosome is kind of ask, well, how did Ravi Shankar play music? Well, Ravi Shankar wanted to be a musician. He studied many years. He was imbued with the spirit of music, and his level of playing is beyond sublime. I mean, actually, Indian music has quarter tones, meaning from octave to octave, there's 24 notes you can play. So we see George Harrison of the Beatles visiting Ravi and learning and him being influenced. But the point is, this is a slide from a couple of webinars ago, if you try and visualize Western music, the different styles, Baroque, classical, and you look at the different notes, chords, progressions used, it comes up with this beautiful like pattern. Again, machine learning is what we need. Humans can't understand this. And it reminds me of the wonderful sci-fi movie Arrival, where these seven-legged creatures came from space and were trying to test us to see if we could understand. And some smart guy figured out that their language is circles, and depending on how the circles are modulated, it can roughly translate into human language, roughly. So we're reminded that we will never understand the songs that these cells are singing to each other, how they work. And so it's an act of faith backed by works, that we see improvement, and we speculate backwards as to how that could be occurring. The best possible explanations are anti-inflammatory effects, reduced autoimmunity, angiogenesis, improved cell behavior and communication, but we can also get regeneration of the stem cells. Who knows, does she or doesn't she? Maybe the stem cells, if you were to take them, are better because they can become and engraft. But mainly we think that now the main effect of MSCs are via the exosomes. So, and that's also in one of the other lectures I saw of Dr. Kaplan. He said the benefit of regeneration is not from engraftment, but rather the effect on the local stem cell niche. In other words, you take the exosomes from this newborn baby donor, and they tell your cells how to behave younger, how to act younger, how to regenerate. And so that's active in all the local niches throughout your body. The principle of dedifferentiation was addressed in the neural regeneration lecture I did. Very interesting. Go see that one if you want to see how a microRNA can block the dedifferentiation and allow these cells to go backwards in time. And then finally, apoptosis or cell death is usually thought to be inhibited by MSCs. In other words, they allow for survival, but there could be a mixed role there, allowing for apoptosis to occur and other cells to replace. So I know it's really sciencey and a lot of use of analogies, but that's kind of what I wanted to convey to you. If you have any questions, you can email me at drpark@rechargebiomedical.com, and there's a lot of information there at my website to learn from as well. So with that, I want to just confess I don't understand what MSC exosomes are, but I'm in good company because neither does the guy who named them. And when you look at all the notes in these, I don't really understand what they're singing, but then again, neither does anyone else. So finally, are they different? Yes, and I think this will segue well into a future webinar. I want to get the scientist from Chimera on. You know, he shared some slides with me. I don't know if he'll share them with you, but he anonymously bought competitors' exosomes and analyzed them, and the results were quite disconcerting if you believe in certain cell markers as identifiers of exosomes. So that'll be a tease for a future episode because I don't really think that there is brand equity out there. I don't think that, I don't know for certain because I've only used one brand, but if these studies are to be believed, it's a really, really scary landscape out there in terms of what people are selling. It's not a trivial thing to grow stem cells, keep them from differentiating, maintaining quality control. It is not a trivial thing. So buyer beware. Anyway, so let me open it up to questions. If you have questions, you can raise your hand. I can unmute you, or you can type them into the chat, and I will close the presentation now. Go ahead.
Good afternoon. Thank you very much. I would like to know, I had stem cells injected in my lower back for a spinal condition, and the pain went away for 18 months.
Wow.
So do you recommend exosomes would be better? Or I don't really understand the difference from the stem cells and the exosomes.
Well, did you have autologous from yourself or off the shelf from a donor?
It was from a donor. It was umbilical cord.
Yeah. Well, I mean, that's a great result. One of the better ones I've heard. Just unscientifically speaking, about 50% of people tell me, oh, nothing happened. And about maybe 30, 40% say it got better for 6 to 12 months. So 18 months is a good amount of relief, I would think.
And the second they were injected in my lower back, the pain went away immediately. Nice. That second for so a whole 18 months.
You had an epidural injection then?
Yeah. Well, no, not an epidural. Just a with a, you know, shot in lower back where the pain is. The L5-S1 area.
Yeah, I presume it was epidural.
I don't know.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I think that's a great result. You know, to some extent, the epidural space may be a little immune privileged. Maybe you couldn't or didn't mount an immune response that destroyed them quickly. Usually, if you inject them IV, they go to the lungs and the spleen, the liver, and they get kind of wasted and used up. So that might have been a good modality for you. So,
well, I did at the same time actually purchase 3 units, and it was one in the lower back, one IV in my arm, and one in my nostrils.
We're talking stem cells.
Yes, but now I'm interested in the exosomes because are they more potent than the stem cells? I don't really understand the difference.
Nobody knows. Obviously, depending on what people are promulgating and selling, they promote one over the other. I think theoretically and scientifically, there's a problem with immune histocompatibility. In other words, your body will chew them up and render them useless. I remember when I did IV stem cells, I felt no effect, but my immune system is very robust. I may have just not benefited from them. So it's anecdotal, but yeah, I would say if you had success with MSCs, it's something to try. But the nice thing about exosomes is by and large, 90% of people who I do exosomes on have some results and they're beneficial. So that's my experience.
Okay, so I will email you then to get further information then.
Sure. Yeah, I mean, I am very hesitant to say, do one or the other just because I do exosomes. If you had a good result, maybe it's something that you would repeat. The 18 months is a long time to feel better, and maybe that's worth it. I don't know what you paid, but in general, the exosomes are, a half to a third as expensive for whatever reason.
Than the stem cells?
Yeah, I would think so. Yeah, generally.
Oh, okay. All right. Thank you for that information.
You're welcome. We have a question here from an attendee. Has Camara moved closer to FDA approval for insurance coverage? I think they have 3 trials currently, one for hypertrophic scar, one for dementia, and one for COVID. So they have received INDs and are in clinical trials. But I would recommend you watch my video on the FDA. The whole issue of intellectual property, FDA approval, is a complex one. It's one I got into when I visited the labs in Florida with the chief scientist and quality control officer. Everyone wants a HeLa. Everyone wants a proprietary thing that they own and that they can allege and presume is reproducible from batch to batch. But the intellectual property aspects of things produced from humans is very dubious. And if you know anything about the FDA, you know that the people that run it are very closely tied to pharmaceutical companies. And so any kind of modality that is not profitable for them and that reduces sickness and disease maintenance would not be roundly welcomed, I would think. Doris says, I heard that exosomes can help me better. It's hard to say in life, as in clinical medicine, we don't really have an A-B experiment where one Dora gets this and the other Dora gets that. So we have to kind of base it on. Where did you go for your stem cells? I wonder, was it Panama? Reardon Clinic? Utah. Well, you know, a couple of days ago, I emailed the owner of Chimera, and we talked on the phone about this edict. Allegedly, I read on Facebook that the FDA was going to shut down exosome companies, so I was thinking of taking out a loan to hoard them. He says that because of their IND process, their laboratory facility will not be shut down. Whether the use of them will be somehow regulated is hard to say because we're not promulgating them as a FDA sanctioned or approved or proven modality. But they have kind of been at loggerheads with the stem cell people. I know the Stem Cell Surgical Network, SCN, has been, the Burmans have been at war with the FDA. Now, who knows what motivates them and why? For the time being, there is access in the States, and then some of the technology is available off overseas where the FDA has drawn a red line, are able to do things like collagenase, which is to break down the fibers in the substance to make it a higher yield, and to clonally expand. Use of stem cells in this country autologously is limited by those two factors. You can't, you have to be minimally manipulated. And for now, they're allowing people to do liposuction, bone marrow aspiration, but they're not allowing you to get that clone army, double to massive numbers in this country. There are people I know, American Cryostem, that will freeze them in their facilities. And then when the time comes, you can go to the Bahamas or Mexico, Costa Rica, and get your clone army re-expanded into you. But there are some sort of governors or blockers in place for regulation, meant, of course, to protect patients and consumers. Okay, good stuff. Any other questions about MSCs? As you can tell, I'm leading with my ignorance. I don't really know that much about stem cells. One of my friends and patients wrote a book, and it's about this thick and could hold a heavy door open. And as I was reading the protocols, the papers, I realized there is a sort of alchemy there. There are formulas where they say, well, you got to use this much oxygen or this much light or CO2 or whatever, and this is how you keep them from differentiating. So it is a live science, and so when you thaw out a batch and you keep those little chickens laying eggs, the question is, you know, how do you keep the chickens happy? Do you scare them? Do you make them miserable? You know, because they're going to express what they're going to express in response to their milieu, and so we don't really know how to get the best exosomes from those chickens or even what that means, best exosomes. So when we revisit the question from Facebook about neural exosomes, we presume she's talking about this stem cell line that came from China. It's from a neural stem cell line, but the question is, you know, it's not just one line that they keep alive forever. They have to cryopreserve them and use this sort of clone army methodology. So, because if you leave a stem cell in a dish over time, after many doublings, the telomeres will shorten, their reproductive capacity will change, their gene expression will change, and the overall quality of their output will be different, maybe poorer. So just like you can't keep a chicken alive for too long and expect good eggs, the same thing with the stem cells. So a lot of the intellectual property stuff is very murky. I'm reminded of Angelina Jolie's breast surgery. I think the company was Myriad or something like that. They have a patent on BRCA gene. And so they were paying her, I don't know, $15 million or something to get a mastectomy to prevent breast cancer. I think she probably just wanted cosmetic surgery, but maybe she believed she was going to get breast cancer and was mitigating that risk. But the Supreme Court, I believe, ruled against them. So they were not allowed to own the BRCA gene for testing, which is interesting. Question from the audience. Does freezing reduce stem cell viability? Oh, yes, it does. And that's the problem. You know, I friends with a lot of the people that own the biggest cryopreservation business. And, you know, they like to gloss over the fact that, you know, in the freezing, the cells kind of get destroyed or get burst. They use the equivalent of antifreeze, and they try and mitigate that, limit that. But who knows? But yeah, when you take stem cells, and they have to be frozen, and you thaw them, I've seen studies saying, you know, up to 90% can be dead on arrival when you thaw them. So it is a non-trivial issue that none of the doctors will ever want to talk about. And I'm presuming it's the same for when they take the exosome-producing MSCs from the mother. I'm sure that there is some lack of viability there too. But they do quality control assays for all the proteins, mRNAs, and every batch. And if you're into one-word answers, the answer was yes when I asked Dr. Ross, are they secreting the same things in their exosomes every batch? He said yes. Question: can you comment on hyperbaric oxygen as a telomere enhancement? Yeah, there's an Israeli study that came out 2 months ago, I think, and it alleged that hyperbaric oxygen in high pressures and high concentrations lengthened telomeres. I did do an interview for Gaia recently on that. If it's up, I will link it. I hope it's true. It needs to be shown in other centers, but it's interesting nonetheless. All right, so that pretty much wraps it up. Again, I think, to be honest, there's no reason to get excited here. It's very complicated. We don't understand it. We just go ahead and we proceed. If it's working, then we keep on doing it and hope for the best. I think that the one-note Samba era is coming, where people will try and put one or two proteins or mRNAs or even microRNAs, but, you know, it's not the same as playing the whole song by the original musician or band. So let us not talk falsely. The hour is getting late. All right, everybody. Thanks for joining in this kind of whirlwind over my head, so probably over most of your heads, lecture on MSCs, what they are, what's in them, and how they work. So until next time, we hope to get Dr. Ross on, and he can show us what he believes is proof that his exosomes are qualitatively different from what's out there in the marketplace. And I think that will be of value. Again, everyone, thanks for joining, and we'll see you next time. This is Dr. Ed Park from Recharge Biomedical. Take care. Bye-bye.